Okay, the last one up of the day. Make sure you've got energy for this. It's a big one. If you were here earlier, you would have already seen one of our two speakers coming up with EDM demonstrating how the intersection of music and tech are a match made in musical heaven. They will demonstrate what it takes to create a track that captures more than 500 million listens across several streaming sites. EDM superstar Jonas Blue, joined by DJ and producer B-Traits, will demonstrate exactly in this unique keynote session. Please give it up. It's the last one of today.
Well, let's hope this works. All right, welcome to this electronic music production masterclass with globally renowned songwriter, producer, and performer Jonas Blue. Now, Jonas is not only a talented artist in his own right, but he also uses this talent to discover and nurture new and undiscovered artists. The track he's walking us through today is titled Wild, and it features a singer from Liverpool, a singer from Argentina, and a rapper from Puerto Rico.
Yeah.
With more than 4 billion streams, 25 million single sales to his name, a brand new debut album released tomorrow, it's my pleasure to be up here with Jonas to walk you through with the Wild.
Hey guys, how are you? I'm going to be running you through one of the tracks from my debut album, Blue, today. Might be a bit different because I've been here sitting watching the other panelists. But yeah, so I'm going to run you through the track, just kind of give you a bit of the background, how it all came together and some of the sounds that I used. And I'll play a bit of the track first so you guys can hear it. And I will get into it after that. Oh, thank you, guys. thank you.
So is that the latest single from the album?
It's going to be one of the singles from the album, yeah. So we shoot the video actually next month. I'm probably not supposed to say anything about it, but yeah, we shoot it next month, which I'm very excited about. So yeah, so I'll kind of basically tell you guys how this came together. I wrote the song with another songwriter and producer called Steve Mack, the songwriter who is actually singing the first and second verse, her name is Chelsea Grimes. So Steve, I'm not sure if you guys know, is most recently known for writing Ed Sheeran's Shape of You. Amazing songwriter, amazing producer. And Chelsea has been, she's from Liverpool, and she's just starting on her artist career, but she's been songwriting for quite a few years now. She's had huge success with people like Little Mix, One Direction, Dua Lipa, and this was actually our first session together. So it's the first time I ever got in with Steve, and this is the first time I got in with Chelsea. The track actually came together whenever I start writing a track, I always have to have a concept or a title or something that's going to kickstart the session off. And I remember I was making the journey up to Steve's studio to have this session, and I saw a shop. There was a shop called Wild, and I thought, oh, that could be a really cool title for a song. So we used that during the day, and I basically, when I start a session, I keep it very, very simple. Mainly, it's just me at the piano. So the first thing that I would have worked on when I got to the studio would have probably been this sound here, which is titled Pluck. So that was the initial melody that I was playing, and I remember Steve and Chelsea were at the back of the room, and I had given them the idea of this song title, Wild. And it kind of started from there. You just kind of start with very basic chord progression, as we call it, which was that. And we got started with the song, and the song is very much influenced from what I, as a DJ, what I play in the clubs. So although it's pop music, it's blended with dance music as well. That's my sound. So if you listen to the drop here, the drop is the big part in the club. And basically, yeah, that's what we worked up to. But that's where the song originally stemmed from and was created. So during the whole session, during the day, it would have just remained as this pluck sound. So we would have had that on loop for probably about 7-8 hours, just that one piece of audio. There wouldn't have been anything else. But I would have then taken the song away that we wrote on the day, and that very basic melody line there, I would have taken it back to my studio and then created all the rest of the production. The most important thing that you work on during a day, especially for me, is the song. I'm trying to write a song that is gonna be timeless, make an impact, and excite people. So that for me remains the focus when I'm doing a writing session. All the production can come afterwards. That's something that I, you know, started from production. So, you know, it's something that it can be done afterwards, but a great song has to be created on the day. It's not something that comes afterwards. You have to have a great concept and a great song which is created on the day. So that's kind of where the track came from and how it was created. There's three vocalists on this song right here, which is quite interesting.
This is what I want to know about.
Yeah, so with my sound has a kind of very global reach. So I tour all around the world as a DJ. My songs are written all over the world. I pretty much, as you see this setup here, this is how I travel and make music on the road. This would be my kind of EasyJet or Ryanair setup where I'll just pull down the tray table and get working. But yeah, it's my music's made all around the world, and especially with this song, I really wanted to incorporate that. So we have the first singer that you hear on the song is Chelsea Grimes, who is the person that I wrote the song with. And you'll be able to hear this. I'm gonna solo this, sorry, there's a lot of tracks. So.
Have you ever been with somebody that makes you feel wild? You couldn't beat this at all if you tried.
So that's Chelsea right there. But the idea was, is that, because the whole song, it, as we wrote the song on the day, it was all Chelsea. But the idea was, is that I wanted to bring a very kind of global sound to this song. So very different, but Chelsea does the verses. When it comes to the pre-chorus, I found a singer called Tini, and Tini's from Argentina. She's a huge star there. She actually was from Disney, and yeah, she's based in Argentina. She's absolutely huge over there. I'm not sure if any of you guys have heard of her, maybe. But this is the whole idea with what I'm trying to do here, where I bring people that you may have never heard of, but are huge in their own countries, and bring them all on this one song to collaborate. So Tini sings the pre-chorus is here.
No lo puedo negar, en mis sueños estás, este juego me vuelve a atrapar y me gusta, no quiero escapar.
And as you can hear, it's not English. The one thing that I wanted to do, we call this a Spanglish version, where you're incorporating English and Spanish. So as you can hear, she's singing in Spanish. And that was great. You know, it added a completely different dynamic to the song, which is what I wanted. And then the third person on the record that we have here was a kind of very last minute thing that we decided to do, which was actually to bring a rapper onto the song, which is a completely new experience for me. And the rapper's name is Jay Cortez, and he's from Puerto Rico. He's absolutely incredible. I'm just going to find this part in the song. Let's see here. There we go. So you have three different types of artists all involved in one record, four if you're counting me as well. So it was great to get this on one song, which is a completely new experience for me. So yeah, that's kind of the gist of how the whole record came together.
So how did you discover each of these artists? And how did you kind of come up with the idea that all of these voices were going to sound great together? What
yeah.
made you decide that?
Well, I'm not sure if many of you guys know my music from before, but I have a kind of tradition where I find new artists that sing on my songs.
Another string to your talent. He's always bringing through new artists or people that we've never heard of before.
But it kind of started from when I came out with my debut single, Fast Car, which was the Tracy Chapman cover. At that time, I couldn't find anyone who was established who wanted to sing my songs, because why would they feature on an unknown dance artist's song? That wasn't how it worked. So it started from that point where I found Dakota, who was the featured artist on Fast Car, and it started turning into a thing where when it came to my second single, we needed to find another vocalist. So I found another vocalist, and then it came to the third record, I needed to find another vocalist, and I wasn't in a position where I could have these, you know, I couldn't have Beyonce or Rihanna or anyone sing my records, because why would they sing my records? I have no leverage at that point. So I was able to find these new talents, and that was purely by going online. Dakota, who sings Fast Car, I discovered her in a bar in London. JP Cooper, who sings Perfect Strangers, which is my second single, he's someone that I knew from quite a few years back. He was singing in pubs and doing like the acoustic circuit in London. When it came to my third single, which features a London talent called Ray, I discovered her in the back of an Uber. The Uber driver told me about his friend's daughter, who's a singer, and she then sang my third single. So it became a thing where I'd start discovering all these talents, and as my credibility and my platform started building, I was kind of developing these new artists that I was finding and giving them this amazing platform. So it kind of stems from there. So going back to the song in question, Wild, I have an ear for the type of voices that I want to have on my records. Chelsea Grimes, who is the first vocalist that you hear coming on the song, she sings the verses, is the person that I actually wrote the song with on the day. It just so happens that she's never released any music and she's just starting on her artist career. And it was like, okay, great. Let's keep you on the record. You sound great. So it's nothing more complicated than that. It was just when I then started wanting to bring other people into the mix. And Teenie was someone that was recommended to me through a friend. They actually said that she could be great. I generally play all my demos for my team and see if they have any ideas for maybe who could be on my songs. And I play it for my friends, see if they've found anyone on Spotify or Apple Music, and just kind of, you know, throw the demos around and see if anyone has ideas. And yeah, Teenie came through a friend and said that she could be great on this song. And I was like, yeah, for sure. Can she record it? So she recorded it a couple of times and sent it over to me, and she stayed on the record. And then Jay Cortez, who's the rapper from Puerto Rico, again, he was someone that came in very last minute, but it was just because I had the idea that I wanted to have a rapper on it that was rapping in Spanish. so they come together in all different places, and this one was very much a word of mouth one. It was through friends telling me about Latin American artists that could, you know, be great for this. So that's kind of where it came from.
Yeah. Taking it back to the technical yes. part of this track, how did you record the vocals when Tini's in Argentina,
yeah.
rappers in Puerto Rico?
Yeah.
How did you do that?
Well, yeah.
Did you fly there?
Did
you let them record it? Did they send it back?
Generally, if I have a gig in those countries, I will for sure go and record them and get it, you know, how I want it to be recorded. In this case, that didn't happen. Tini actually recorded it with an engineer friend of mine based out there, and I just wrote a bunch of notes and was on FaceTime with them and asked them exactly how I wanted it to go. And yeah, she recorded it remotely and sent me over the files. It was as simple as that. A WeTransfer link came through and into the song it goes. And that was the same with Jay Cortez, the rapper. I had a very clear idea of how I wanted the rap to sound, the length of it, what I wanted him to talk about. And again, he got it done in, I think, a couple of hours and sent it over to me, and you just throw it in. I think you can even see by the file names that's how his engineer sent it over to me. So you have, just as an example, you have the lead vocal. And then you have all the extra parts, such as... I'm not sure if you guys can hear that.
Did they send the vocals over raw? So did you have to comp them yourself, or did you let them comp them?
Yeah, generally what happens is I ask for two versions. I'll ask for a raw version, and then I'll ask for the version how they want it to be heard on the record. And then depending whether I like it or not, I'll either use theirs or I use mine, or I'll match mine similar to theirs, but to how I want it. So it kind of varies. But I always ask for two versions for sure, yeah.
Quite nice. You can get their interpretation of how they
exactly.
feel which yep. take was their best
exactly.
or their favorite. Okay, cool. So next elements, let's, I don't know, move into some percussions and drums.
Yeah, next elements. So as I mentioned on the day, it would have been very simple. It would have been the pluck sound that you've heard there, which is just me playing the piano in a kind of very plucky way.
I like that. I call them shells. Like,
yeah.
A shell of a record, basically, and it's the backbone of a track. It's what gives it the groove. It's what sets the vibe. It sets the tone.
Exactly.
And then you kind of go in and fill that shell with
exactly.
all the detailed elements, like kicks, drums.
Yeah, exactly. But the one main thing, if you listen to all my other records, I always start with melody. So we would have had the concept for the song on the day, but I would have been working on the melody there and then, and that's what you hear. So that's why I always start my tracks with melody, because that's how the tracks actually start when we're writing them. So that's how it would have started. The next elements here, going into the verse. In the darkest of nights when all back. So we would have had some kick drums. I think there's a kick. There's some claps here, there's some percussion, and then that's where the first bass line.
Is this actually how tidy your Logic projects are?
Yeah, so I have the worst OCD. if projects aren't named correctly and things aren't in a certain order, I will literally, can you say, I don't know if you can say it on stage, but I will literally lose my shit. I literally cannot handle. It's like having a messy house.
They're not color-coded, though. Well,
they're kind of. They're not color-coded, but I know the order. So I know that everything's always in this order. All my tracks are always in this order.
What?
So...
Very tidy.
Very tidy. So going back to it, this... Where Tini comes in is where all the elements come in. So kick drums, claps, snares, percussion, and the first bass line, which is this. And that would have been the backbone against the first melody that I created, which is these plucks, which is this. It was at a later date where I still didn't feel that was hooky enough. I didn't feel that was going to draw people in and keep their attention going. So it was actually at a later date where I came up with the melody that goes on top of that, which is this. This is the second melody that goes on top of the plucks. So when you put all those elements together with the bass, with the kick drums and the percussion, it sounds like this. So yeah, this part here has a very kind of urban influence. The drums that I'm using here are what a lot of the kind of rap guys are using at the minute. They call it trap music. And I'll be using a lot of those elements, but bringing it into my world of dance music and pop music. So there's a lot of elements that have come from the rap world at this specific point in the song. It's then when we get further into the song, the drop element, where, you know, the drop is the main part that you would play in the club and it would go off, is where I start introducing different sounds. So. It doesn't crash. And that, basically what I've done there is I had all the kind of very percussive elements all leading up to it, which is here. So it's all very percussive, and it could probably stay like that if you wanted to keep it as like a traditional pop song. But, you know, we both come from the dance world, and you know, when it comes to, you know, whether it's techno that you make or you know any type of dance music, generally when it comes to the drop, it will go down to a kick drum and very minimal elements, and that's essentially what I've done here. It goes down to the kick drum and the bass line. So I'm just going to show you some of these elements. We have three kick drums, so I'm just going to play the kick drums and the bass line.
Usually when this works in a record,
yeah,
you know you got a hit.
Sorry, it keeps crashing. There's a lot of tracks going on this record. But yeah, generally when you get those two elements right, the kick drum and the bass line, that's generally in the dance world when you know it's going to work in the clubs. And that's what I bring into, you know, my world with pop music. It's kind of very different because I'm fusing these two sounds together, but it seems to work. So, as mentioned, you'll have all that kind of percussion-y stuff, and then it will go straight down. And it's a very, very simple drop, but again, very, you know, very memorable. The melodies stick in your head, and hopefully the chorus does as well. So, yeah, those are kind of some of the main elements that are there. Maybe we want to...
Where are the sounds coming from? Do you use any outboard, or are you sampling?
Yeah, I mean, it comes from a whole bunch of different stuff. A lot of the sounds are stuff that I've sampled. So I tend to use these brass hits, which come from kind of very classic I have a lot of kind of jazz and opera records where I'd sample them. So you'd generally hear those in
So walk us through how you would have sampled that and basically created that melody.
I would have, if we go to one of the layers here, let's see what this is. So Brass Stab JB, it would have been something that I've sampled from vinyl. And this is called a sampler. What we've got here is called a sampler. So I would have taken just one sample and stretched it across the keyboard, so you can literally just... It's all the same sound, but it's playing in different pitches because of the keyboard. So that would have been one of the layers, and then I would have layered it and layered it and layered it, just the same melody, but different kind of sounds, different brass sounds. So, just gonna have a look at this one. this is actually a plugin here. Synthmaster 1 is a plugin that I use a lot. And it looks like I've used one of the bass sounds from the presets. And what I've done there is essentially layer the original sound that I put in the record, because I obviously didn't feel it was strong enough and it needed extra harmonics to make it stronger. So that is just one of the elements that goes into the production and one of the sounds there. So when you play all of them together, it sounds like so. Sorry, without the bass line. And then when you start pulling it with the initial sound that I went into the session with, it sounds like this. You then add the other melody, the secondary melody that it should be here. And it all starts to kind of work with each other. And as you can see here, that one lead line, that one melody lead line, which is this, I'm going to solo it just now. You're listening to it as one sound, but it took 11 sounds to get it to that point. So I can just quickly show you some of the layers. Go back. You can start hearing the harmonics start building up. And that's kind of how many sounds it took for me to be comfortable with the sound that I wanted to put in the record. So
How do you decide when it's finished, like when you're happy with that many layers?
I think it's just, you know, through years of being a producer, you know how you want a thing, you know, a melody to sound. You know, I think just looking at this, obviously that's a lot of layers there where, you know, maybe I wouldn't have done that in the very start, but it took that many to get it where I wanted it to in my head and where I wanted it to sound like, and I knew would make an impact in the actual mix of the song. So there's a lot of different layers there, and they've come from all different plugins. You know, some of the plugins that I use here are Nexus, which is a great plugin.
Nexus is excellent.
What else have we got here? The EXS24, which is actually, it's got no sound in it at all. It's just the tone. So.
Just literally just adding a little bit of something underneath.
Just adding a little bit of harmonic to which I felt it needed. So it's just the kind of, it's just the gut feeling, knowing when you feel that it works for you. You know, maybe for other people that might be too much, but to me that felt right and exactly how I wanted the record to sound. So yeah, there are a lot of layers to this record. It's quite interesting, but yeah.
No, you're right. As a producer, that's all you're trying to do is get the sound that you have in your head into that computer.
Yeah, and you know, someone once always told me that it's what comes up. You want to get whatever's up here as quick as you can out of here onto there, and that's this process for me. And you know, I work in a very streamlined way now with just my laptop, and there's not much gear, you know, in terms of keyboard and synthesizers around me. I can just have my focus on the computer, and anything that I'm thinking in my mind, I can just put it straight out onto the computer and get it there as quick as I can.
Cool, we've only got 5 minutes left, so I want to talk arranging.
Yes, arranging.
So with pop music, are you approaching it completely different to what you would do for your electronic stuff? Like, what makes a pop record big? Like, it's usually the arrangement has like a massive hand in it.
Yes. So I actually arrange my tracks in a very different way to many other dance producers. I actually start by doing the radio edit. And what I mean by that is the version that will actually be on radio.
Whereas so it's like 3.5 minutes long.
Less.
Really, really short. Yeah, it is actually. Yeah. On daytime radio, it'll be really short.
Yeah.
Maybe like 2.5 minutes.
2.5 minutes is kind of what I aim for. And within that 2.5 minutes, I have to be excited about the song. You know, when I was slightly younger and I was just purely making dance music, those songs would be 7-8 minutes long and it would start with a kick drum for just 1 minute. You know, in this instance, I actually pull from a lot of my inspirations, and one of those inspirations is a guy named Max Martin. Max Martin is a songwriter and producer who is one of my biggest idols. He's written all the Backstreet Boys, NSYNC, Britney Spears, to now Taylor Swift, Katy Perry. He's one of the biggest music producer songwriters there are. And I remember once watching in an interview that he had done, he basically said that with Britney Spears, Baby One More Time, that song, as soon as you played it, from the second that it came in, you knew what it was, purely by that piano, that dun, 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 and that was it. It's the same with Michael Jackson, Billie Jean. As soon as you play that record, you know what it is. There's no denying what that song is. As soon as it comes in, there's something there. You know, in the Billie Jean case, it's the drum beat. Everyone knows that drum beat. With Baby One More Time, Britney Spears, it's the piano. As soon as it comes in, you know what it is. So I take that method and always put that into my records. So as soon as you start this song and you press play, whether it's on Spotify or Apple Music or iTunes,
you get the hook.
You're in. It doesn't take 7 seconds or 30 seconds to get into the song, it's instant. So that's something different that I do in my world, because a lot of dance producers would not do that.
There's nothing worse as well after creating a record that's like 7 minutes long
to try and then
having to condense it down to a radio edit.
Yeah, and this is the great thing about this, is that when you work the way I do, which is radio edit based, you can then take the track out and arrange it bigger. It's a lot easier to take it out afterwards and make it longer to 4 or 5 minutes or 6 minutes if you want, than, as B said, taking it, you know, from 6-7 minutes down to 2.5 minutes. It's very difficult. So the arrangement, as I mentioned, I make sure that it starts with the melody, you know, for me, or a vocal melody or the chorus. I start with something that's going to draw people in and hook people in straight away, so that their interest is kept there. And even more so, I did a panel a couple of weeks ago in Amsterdam, and basically one of the reasons why I also do this is you have things such as Spotify and you have Apple Music, and when your song is released, generally on a Friday, if your song goes into a playlist with 50 other songs, you want to hook people in from that first second. If people have got to go through another 30 songs to check out a playlist, and your song takes 30 seconds to get into it, to draw people's attention in, then you might just lose people's interest and the song might not do what it needs to do. So that's one of the reasons why I always start with melody and a hook that's going to have people interested in. The next thing that I always start with, so you'll have an intro, whether it's 4 bars or 8 bars, the next thing will always be the verse. I'll always go straight into the verse. As you can hear, it comes straight in with Chelsea right here. And all of a sudden, you're listening to the story of the song and you're hooked. And then it just kind of progresses from there. And basically, the one thing that I do that's also different from my records to other pop records, let's say, is I then take it back to my dance roots, where when it goes to the drop, it sounds like a dance record. It sounds like one of the classic house records that I would have played in the clubs, or you know, just something that's completely different to what's on radio at the minute. And that's why I wanna get wild with you. That just sounds like something that I would play in the clubs. So I'm just kind of incorporating all my elements into the arrangement, but it is kind of very much arranged like a pop record. And you know, that's kind of in the sense of you have your verse, you have your pre-chorus, you have your chorus, and then you repeat those sections again. And, you know, it becomes something that's repetitive and memorable for everyone and keeps people hooked. So that's generally how my arrangements work.
Awesome. Well, we are now out of time. That was brilliant. Thank you so much,
Thank
Jonas.
You. Thank you.
And the album is out tomorrow.
The album's out tomorrow. If you guys want to check it out, Blue, the debut album, is out tomorrow. I'm very excited, and I hope you guys check it out and like it. So thank you very much once again, everyone. Appreciate it. Thank you.